Chihuahua.
Welcome to our Bible study again from the Cumberland Presbyterian Encounter material. Last week we looked at Romans 5 and the fact that Christ died for us while we were still sinners. In Romans 6, our passage today, Paul considers for us, or helps us consider, the implications of Christ's death for us. What does it mean that we are now free from death, free from sin? And so let me share with you Romans 6, 1 through 14. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may increase? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore we were buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead for the glory of the Father, so we also might walk in newness of life. For if we've been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, so we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin. But if we died with Christ, we believe that we also will live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies, so that you obey their desires. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. Now, Paul is saying a lot in here, but in some ways he's saying the same thing over and over again. And let me begin our study with this little story. You may have heard it before. You may remember that President Calvin Coolidge was known as Silent Cal. He didn't have a lot to say. And the story, which I assume is true, that one Sunday he left the White House and went to worship, but his wife stayed behind because she wasn't feeling well. And so he goes to church, and then he comes back to the White House, goes into the room where she is, and she says, "Well, Cal, how was worship?" And he says, "Fine." "Well, did the preacher have a good sermon? How was the sermon?" "It was fine." "Well, Cal, what did the preacher talk about?" "Sin." "Well, Cal, you're not helping me at all here. What did he have to say about sin?" "He was against it." "Well, in a sense, preacher are against sin, Paul is against sin, God is against sin." And part of what this chapter then is trying to ask, since we are free from sin, since grace frees us from sin, what do we do with sin? Maybe we can sin all the more we want. And Paul begins kind of with almost a silly question. If grace abounds and Christ's death frees us from all sin, why are we not free to sin all we want if it doesn't have any consequences over us anymore? And part of the answer to that, the whole answer to that is, of course not. Just because we can sin doesn't mean that we should. And I think that's really the answer that Paul is giving us. You may have heard people say, just because you can do something doesn't necessarily mean that you should do something. One of the things I love most in all the world is ice cream. And I could buy a whole carton of ice cream, and wanted to, I could eat the entire carton. And it's a temptation. How wonderful that would be to consume an entire carton of ice cream. But just because I can eat it, doesn't mean that I should eat it, of course. And at first, it might be wonderful to eat that carton of ice cream, but by the time I got to the bottom, I might be sick of it, and it might actually literally make me sick. Even if it didn't make me sick in the moment, it certainly would increase my waistline in ways that I would rather not have that happen, and I would have some long-term effects there. It would help clog up my arteries and might contribute to a heart attack, and that might even be an early heart attack. I mean, it's sooner rather than later, or a heart attack at some later time. Just because I can doesn't mean I should. And so with ice cream, I should take it in moderation. We don't take our sin in moderation, but just because I can sin doesn't mean that I should. And if I do sin, it is going to cause me problem. I have been released from the ultimate consequences of sin. And so I don't have to suffer eternal death because of sin. And yet that doesn't mean that I am exempt from the more short-term consequences of sin. I've had a number of folks as a pastor who have come to me and they are dealing with the consequences of their sin and it has wrecked their lives. Of course, I have done things in my life and you've done things in your life that harmed other people and that in one way or another wrecked your life. And maybe it was only for the short term, but if you could go back and take that back, those words you said, those things you did, whatever it was, you probably would, because it just isn't worth it for the pain and the agony and the death it causes, whether it's a death of a relationship or a short-term death in a relationship or whatever. We wouldn't do that. Frederick Buechner, a great Presbyterian minister, just died just a few months ago, I think, has a wonderful thing to say about anger and why we shouldn't engage in excessive anger, but it also really speaks to all of sin. This is his definition of anger. Of the seven deadly sins, anger is possibly the most fun. To lick your wounds, to smack your lips over grievances long past, to roll over your tongue the prospect of bitter confrontations still to come, to savor to the last toothsome morsel both the pain you are given and the pain you are given giving back. In many ways, it is a feast fit for a king. The chief drawback is what you're wolfing down is yourself. The skeleton at the feast is you. Paul tells us toward the end of this passage, therefore don't let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey their desires. And that's what Paul is saying. The anger that we have for others, there's a great desire we have. Boy, this is going to be fun when I think about the wounds that I have been given and how that makes me so angry at that person, to lick my lips over grievances long past and to roll over my tongue the prospect of bitter confrontations to come. Have you not thought through your mind, played out, boy, if I see that person again, what I would say to them, I'd give them a piece of my mind, all of that. To hang on to those resentments, in one sense, is a feast fit for a king. But here's the problem. The skeleton, what you're wolfing down is yourself. What I'm eating is myself. I'm eating myself, consuming myself from the inside out. That's all I can focus on. The skeleton at the feast is me. And so I can give over to those desires that my instinct suggests that I do. And it's not just about anger, but any sin. Initially, it seems good. It seems fun. I had a professor in seminary that used to teasingly sing the song, I was sinking deep in sin. Yippee! And at first, it feels that way. And then we find that indeed we are sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. We find that the waves of death are rolling over us. And so why would we sin even though the consequences in the long term are taken away from us? Why not sin continually? Because the short term consequences are horrible and we're missing out living in life. Now, what Paul really is doing in this chapter is reminding the Romans and reminding us of a very familiar story. It's the story of the people of Exodus. When they are prisoners to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh holds complete power over their lives, and Pharaoh in this analogy really represents death. And God comes and saves them from death. And imagine, there they are in the outside of Egypt. They've escaped, but they're on the shore of the Red Sea, and there is Pharaoh's army coming towards them. And they're afraid they're going to die, and there's nothing they can do. They're going to be trampled over by the army. But what does God do? God opens up the sea and they pass through the waters. And so Paul says, we do the same thing in baptism. God opens up the waters of baptism, not because we have the power to save ourselves, but because God does. And we go through those waters. And then the people get on the other side. And they are safe from death. Pharaoh cannot reach them. The waters are preventing that. And yet, what happens? Well, they then kind of enslave themselves. They begin grumbling and complaining about Moses and about God. And it takes God 40 years to train them how to trust God and trust God's provisions. They didn't have to wander literally in the wilderness of sin for 40 years, but they did because they grumbled and they complained and they refused to learn and they wanted to stay in their sin, stay in their slavery, even though God had set them free. They could have gone into the promised land, the land of milk and honey. Instead, they had to wander around in the wilderness so that God could teach them more. Paul is saying, now that you've been set free from sin through baptism, through coming through the water, why in the world would you return again to a slavery? Why would you enslave yourself and make it that much harder on you and really, in a sense, that much harder on God? Why not walk in this newness of life? Why not experience the life that God wants you to have right here and right now? So Paul's first instruction, I suppose you might say, in Romans 6 is we don't have to wander in the wilderness of sin. We can claim the promised land in the here and the now. Now, the ultimate promised land, the ultimate kingdom of God comes at the end of time, and we don't know when that will be. But we can experience the kingdom of God, the promised land, right here and now, the life and the joy that God wants us to have through Jesus Christ. Now, we in the Presbyterian Church, of course, baptize infants. Some would say, well, that's not coming through the waters and being saved, because eventually you have to claim that baptism. And that's true, and yet how powerful it is that we baptize infants. And I have to say that it was not until I became a Cumberland Presbyterian that I really understood infant baptism. I grew up a Baptist, but I went to Duke, a Methodist school, for my Master's of Divinity, and then I went to Columbia Theological Seminary, a Presbyterian seminary, for my doctorate. But I didn't really understand what infant baptism is all about until I became Cumberland Presbyterian. And we very clearly in our confession link baptism in the New Testament to circumcision in the Old Testament. And what happens in the Old Testament is when a male child is born, they are circumcised, and that is a way of saying you are a part of the covenant community. God has already claimed you as His. Now, every Jewish person, male or female, ultimately has to accept those promises that God gives. They're free to walk away from the community, free to walk away from God, and so at some point they have to claim, but they claim what is already true, that when you were born into God's community. And we take it back a little further as well. When Adam and Eve were brought into creation, God had plans for them, and then through their sin, those plans get wrecked. And God wants eventually, though, to restore all of us to the ability to, one of those wonderful phrases in Genesis, walk with God in the cool of the evening, to be completely present with God. And through baptism, we are reminded that God is going to reclaim us if we will accept what God has for us. Our lesson writer had an interesting analogy here or image here. If you remember the Disney movie, the film The Lion King, at the very beginning, we have Simba who is born, and this new Lion King, this new prince is born, and eventually he will become the king. And Rafiki, the monkey, who is kind of the minister, if you will, comes and he takes Simba and he breaks this some sort of a fruit, and he kind of baptizes Simba with this fruit, and then he holds Simba aloft for all the animals to see. Here is the one who will eventually be your king. Well, what Rafiki is saying is this isn't the king yet, any more than an infant who is baptized is already a follower of Christ. And yet God's plans for this infant and the plans for Simba is that he will be this promise that God has made and will accept this promise. Well, in The Lion King, and then what happens next in that scene, it's really amazing how baptismal it is. As he holds him aloft, the whole congregation celebrates. Yes, this is God's work among us, in a sense. All the animals are celebrating. And then this ray of light comes down from heaven almost and surrounds the king. And then everyone bows down. And hopefully, when we see that scene in our analogy, they're not worshiping Simba, but they're bowing down in worship of the God who is promising to make Simba everything that he is supposed to be, just as God promises to make us everything that we are supposed to be. that story, it continues, and Simba ends up, through his carelessness, essentially getting his father killed, and he blames himself really more than he should have, but he goes off and he wanders in the wilderness, if you will, for many, many years, he's not happy because he discovers that back home, everything is falling apart. They don't have a king, and they need a king, and then through a vision he has, hears his father saying to him, "Simba, remember who you are." And that can be our story as well. We are baptized at some point, and then we walk away from it, and we wander in the wilderness. But at some point, we need to hear God say to us, "Remember who you are. Remember that I claimed you at baptism, and nothing has changed that." And so you can come and claim who you are. And Simba does that, and not only does that reclaim for him who he is, but then that begins the process of a new calling for him, reclaiming the pride lands for those, all of the animals, for being able to be who God has called him to be and bring life back. And God gives us that opportunity as well. And so that might be something to reflect on a little bit, that wonderful, wonderful story. And in a sense, that is Romans 6 in a nutshell. We are baptized. We are claimed even in infancy as a part of God's community. And God has a plan for us to reclaim us back to what we always were supposed to be before sin ruins the world. And we don't have to wait until the end of time. We can live in that in the here and the now, but we have to accept it. And when we wander away from it, we want to get back to it as soon as we can. Just because Christ has saved us, because grace abounds, does that mean we sin all the more? No, of course not. Because we want to live in the life that Christ has for us now. And then the calling we have is to help others come back into that life as well. One final story that connects to all of this. In the very early years of the church, we have some records of the early church and the way they would baptize. And they would baptize at dawn as the sun was coming up, a symbol of new life. And actually, the Lion King begins with the dawn as well. You may remember that the very first scene you see is the sun coming up. And what would happen is as the sun is rising, the person would come, and the baptistry sometimes would be dug out of the ground. And this would be an adult coming. They would step up to the baptistry, and it would be dug in the shape of a cross. And as just before they stepped into the waters there, maybe steps that led down, maybe the long section of the cross, they would take off their robes and come into the baptistry naked. And that sounds kind of strange to us, but the idea is that when we are born, we come into the world naked and completely helpless. And when we come into our second birth, when we come into our baptism, we acknowledge we are naked and completely helpless. When we are born, if our parents do not care for us, then we have no hope. During our second birth, if God does not care for us, there's nothing we can do to save ourselves, and we will die just as if we are born and our mother just leaves us on the side of the road or whatever. We're going to die. Likewise, if God does not save us, if God does not provide for us, we cannot live. And so they come into the water naked, and someone would baptize them, probably someone standing on the crossbar, and then we kind of baptize them across the other crossbar, bring them back up. And then when they finished, when the baptism was over, rather than going back out the way they came, they go back out the opposite direction, back up through the front of the cross, because you're not going back to that old way of life, but you're coming into a new way of life. And as they step to the top, someone would wrap them in a brand new, fresh robe, putting on Christ, going into a brand new way of life. And just as the ancient Israelites did when they came through the Red Sea, don't go back to that old slavery, but go forward into the new life that Christ has for you. That is the calling we have in Romans 6. God is against sin because God knows that sin will harm us. God wants us to experience life and not to experience any of the death that sin brings. And so he calls us to that. And we know that there are going to be times that we all sin. We still live in a fallen world. There are going to be times when we do surrender to the earthly desires that we have. I want to offer one final suggestion, a way to lessen that, a way to greater live into the life that God has for us. And that is through the daily spiritual discipline of the examine. I don't know if you've ever heard of that before or not, but it's a way at the very end of the day, preferably just before you go to sleep, but it doesn't have to be then, but sometimes toward the end of the day when kind of the work for the day is over, spend just a very few minutes, you can do it in under 5 minutes, looking back over your day, and there's kind of a process you follow. You first just look back over the day, when did I get up? And was I rushed or was I relaxed when I got up? Was I excited about the day or kind of dreading the day? What did you do for breakfast and between breakfast and lunch and then between lunch in the afternoon and then afternoon into the evening up until that moment, and just kind of relive the day. What were some major things that happened during the day? Some things that maybe you're grateful for. And then you look back and you think, now where was God with me during the day? And sometimes I was aware of it. Wow. At that moment, the hair just kind of stood up on the back of my neck, or I just was so aware of God's presence. Other times it may not be until we're looking back and, you know, I didn't think about it, but I was in the car and that song came on, or that person said that thing to me, or whatever, I laughed, or, you know, whatever it was. God was really present with me there, and I kind of miss seeing it now, but I'm thankful for it now, and to remember and to see the way that God was with me. And then you ask yourself, what were some ways that God called me to do things? And when did I do things right? We need to be aware that we do get so many things right. And sometimes it feels like the church always just wants to ask us, well, how did you mess up? But when did you accept God's call? When I had the chance to give that middle finger salute to that person on the highway when they cut me off, and instead I thought, no, I'm not going to do that. That's an invitation that you accepted. When I was kind to someone, when I offered someone a charity, when I offered someone forgiveness they didn't deserve, whatever it might be, how did I accept God's call? But then we do have to do that not so pleasant work of saying, when did I miss God's call? Maybe I did give that third finger salute. Maybe I had the chance to be kind and instead I was rude or brusque. Maybe I knew God was calling me to do something and I didn't. Maybe I succumbed to a temptation and I know I did. That's when we offer confession. And that's not easy. But if I don't offer confession for the sin that I have, I'm just going to make that same sin over and over again. I'm going to commit that same sin over and over again. And so this is a way to come to grips with that. And then I love the way that the examine is to end. It ends with a prayer asking God, help me be aware of your presence with me tomorrow. Because if tomorrow I am aware of your presence, I'm going to live in your life. I'm going to be in the promised land more often than not. And at the end of tomorrow's, when I do my examine, I may discover that I didn't have as many sins as I did today. Or if I do, I know I still have a way that God can bring me out of those. And so I invite you to try that. Maybe try that this day and see if it's something you can't work into your daily rhythm, so that we can acknowledge, yes, I've been baptized in Christ, saved from sin, and now I want to live as sin-free a life as I can, not so that I'm holier than thou, but so that I'm living in life and so that I'm offering life to other people. And we can do that, of course, because God is always with us, always helping us, always assisting us. Amen.